Hi guys, today Chloe and I are leaving London for a weekend up north in the countryside. We're staying in a barn converted into a cottage in the Peak District with Chloe's mother, brother, sister-in-law and baby niece. And we'll be attending Chloe's cousin's wedding in a nearby stately home that she and her fiancé have hired for the ceremony and reception. And we'll probably go for a walk in the countryside and enjoy some of the open spaces and wildlife. Right now we're transitioning from summer into autumn, so hopefully the weather will be fine, especially for the wedding. So let's go. You may be wondering why I have a van, not a car. I stopped buying cars a long time ago and switched to motorcycles. I'd love to own a car, but in London where I live right now, they are more of an inconvenience than a convenience. I can't park anywhere near my home for free or without the risk of parking fines. Getting the train, tube or bus has its ups and downs, but driving has become just increasingly less and less convenient than public transport for me. The latest thing is 20 mile an hour speed limits with speeding cameras, which I appreciate is safer, but it's pretty tedious. So when I want to leave London, I just rent one. Anyway, why do I have a van is what Chloe wants to know too. Was it all they had, she said? Nope. I could have got a small car like a Fiat 500 or something. You can get big cars too, you can get supercars if you really want. Small cars are great in town, but for flying nearly 200 miles up the motorway, I prefer a van. Well, an Aston Martin Jag or Bentley GT would be nice, but they cost loads to hire. I like the ride height of a van. You get much better visibility because you're higher up than a car, and of course, a lot more room.
Arrived at Peak District National Park.
Years ago, they used to be like driving a bus, but now they're just like driving a car. There is a certain stereotype of the white van man here in the UK, so Chloe is furious we're going to a wedding in one. I watched a Jeremy Clarkson, do a piece once about how people despise BMW drivers. No one lets them out at junctions or gives way to them. Basically, if you get behind the wheel of one, you will be shown no courtesy whatsoever by other drivers, only hate. In a white transit van, it's the complete opposite. It's weird. All of a sudden, you're king of the road. A humble, hard-working king, but king nevertheless. Everyone lets you out at junctions. Everyone gives you right of way in narrow roads. It's great. It actually takes a little getting used to. I think Chloe just pretends to hate them. She looks pretty comfy with her feet up on the dash, and she gets travel sick in cars, but not vans for some reason. It's pitch black here, so I'll show you the cottage later in daylight when you can actually see it. As I said, we're going to a wedding. I'll film the whole day and make a video for Chloe, a private video. Weddings are quite an intimate affair, and maybe she can give it to her cousin as a wedding gift. Although, she has quite a low opinion of my filmmaking ability, so she will probably just delete it rather than gift it. I'll share a little of the day in my vlog, the venue, which should be amazing, and some of the festivities, but not the ceremony. It will give you a little taste of a great British wedding. The cottage has a lovely fireplace, a wood-burning stove, so I'm going to enjoy the fire and a glass of wine and get an early night.
I don't know when we've all met her, when we've come across her, but she had such a strange She lived for the first 2 years of her life on a gypsy site, on a moor, on a windswept moor in Sheffield. I don't know if anybody knows that, but it's a very humble beginning. And one of the things an old gypsy woman said on the site was that she had old woman's eyes, which I certainly meant she'd been here before. And I think that she's shown the wisdom through her life. People say, "Oh, are you proud of your daughter?" Well, I think pride is a strange thing to say, like you've done something. but I think for me it's been more of an amazement of what she's actually done, where she's actually gone in her life, you know, and that's something else, you know, nothing to do with me, you know, she's gone, and she's, you know, like the theme of things about you know, travel. And she's flown to the point where she's just flown. You know, we rebel. You know, I rebelled against my friends. I don't know if it's rebellion, but she's gone somewhere all of her own. You know, nothing to do with me or love. She's just taken off. She's flown and she's gone. You know, and look at this, you know. This is this is nothing. I could ever imagine. She's got this warm, this beauty, but you know, this way. Where she's gone, and the only thing I've written down is one bit of William Blake. And the William Blake poem, it's actually, it's called A Proverb from Hell, which is, sounds odd, but this is the piece, and I'm not doing very well here. I've had too much to drink, I'm going to try and get this out of Thursday. Which is, no bird flies too high if she flies on her own wings. And I think that's what Kelly's done. She's flown her own wings. And that's something so too high. You know, and maybe she'll fly high enough, you know, maybe she'll fly, you know. And with Michael, and, you know, he showed himself to be, you know, a true romantic, which is everything we could hope for, so, you know, and I think it's lovely, and thanks for all coming, and that's it, forget about the words, and I'd like to thank this Kelly and Michael, and I wish them all the happiness for, you know, tomorrow as the manager. Well, there you go, see ya.
Woman's right of ownership, and I hope you're all listening to these ladies. Till 1920, all a married woman could own, legally anyway, was her marriage certificate to prove that she was married. Everything else belonged to the man. Now, whether you think... Now, he's a solicitor, so he should know that when the Representation of the People's Act number 1 was passed by Lloyd George, that was the start of equal opportunities. So, I'm never quite sure whether the man's lost a lot of authority or whether the lady has actually gained. What I would say, we're nearly 100 years on and we still actually haven't got full equal opportunities. But I'm sure there is a solicitor in Russia who is working on that. However, there's a bit of fact in there mixed up with a bit of nonsense. Now, I'm going to still give you this because we've established in the registration service that in 92.5% of households, it is the lady of the house, the wife, you yourself, eh? Who are most likely to know where to put it? But far more importantly, where to find it. And in the case we have equal opportunities with two sentences, I'm sure still it will be your responsibility.
Father in heaven, thy name be hallowed. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Like fire, I'm so in love with you. Dreams are like angels, they keep bad at bay. Love is the light, scaring darkness away. Yeah, I'm so in love with you. Purge the soul. Make love your goal. The power of love. make love your keep the vampires from your door. When the chips are down, I'll be around with my undying, death-defying love for you. Envy will hurt itself. Let yourself be beautiful, sparkling love flowers and pearls and pretty girls. Love is like an energy rushing in, rushing inside of me. Sublime, lovers entwined, divine, divine. Love is danger, love is pleasure. Love is pure, the only treasure. I'm so in love with you, hurts the soul. Make love your
in which we're staying this weekend. These are Ashford Farm cottages. They're barn conversions right here in the heart of the Peak District National Park, right on the edge of a picturesque village called Ashford in the Water. And they're situated just a few minutes walk from yesterday's wedding venue, Thornbridge Hall, and in some beautiful countryside, surrounded by fields and with walks right from the very door. It's still a working beef and arable farm, supplying Aberdeen Angus cattle to Waitrose and local butchers. The cottages are converted former cattle sheds, and they're really nice, but they still retain a little character of the barns they once were, with exposed beams both here on the ground floor and up in the bedrooms. Yesterday's wedding was lovely, and we didn't stay too late. Apparently there is an underground bar that looks just like a nightclub under the stable block of Thornbridge Hall, where the party continued until late, but we have a baby with us, so we stayed well past her bedtime and also probably her parents' bedtime. And I guess babies, I mean, lie-ins are not an option, but it also means we're capable to go for a walk in this countryside today. Let me put you down here and show you the beautiful view from the cottage. I don't come to the countryside much. The really open spaces and the wildlife is amazing, but I never really feel the need, although when I'm here I really enjoy it. I think when people think of London, where I live and have lived all my life, they think of the iconic images of the city. Thousands of years of human activity that's touched every part of the landscape. They basically think of brick and concrete. But London is shaped by nature too. It has four World Heritage Sites: the Palace of Westminster, the Tower of London, Maritime Greenwich, and the Royal Botanical Gardens at Kew. And over 8 million people call London home, but it also boasts more than 8 million trees and thousands of species of wildlife. There are parks, royal parks, gardens, allotments, woodlands, heaths, commons. London is one of the greenest cities in the world for its size. This is amazing, but London can be outstanding for its outdoor recreational activities too. To the extent, I don't really miss it enough to make the long journey, but I probably should make more effort more often. The air quality is something we really lack though. Fresh country air is amazing. Chloe seems to have mistaken the countryside for a petting zoo, and despite her desperate efforts, most of the animals, except for the cows, are really not up for being stroked. Scared it.
Hello?
Sometimes you have to ask yourself, how did I get here and why? We're in a field full of not just cows, half of these are young bulls. I'm not sure what's more dangerous, a young bull or its protective mother. Either way, we've got to get through here as fast, carefully and quietly as possible. Turns out each year a number of people are killed by not just bulls, but also cows protecting their young. So, we're from London, we have no idea what we're doing, but don't try this at home. If you can find another way around a field full of either bulls or cows with their young, go the other way. Thank you. This is where we've been walking to, Monsall Head. It's a short walk from our cottage and it overlooks Monsall Dale, which is where I shot the time lapse earlier in the vlog. It's one of the most picturesque and photographed spots in England. You have the combination of the River Wye running through the steep-sided dale and the old railway viaduct spanning it. When they built the viaduct here in 1863, there was huge opposition as it was seen as destroying the natural beauty of the dale. Funnily enough, when the railway closed and they planned to demolish it in the 1960s, there was again huge opposition to that and a preservation order was placed upon it. The railway line that ran along that viaduct has long been shut and the track has been lifted, but apparently from time to time there are plans to reopen it. And theoretically it's still possible, but right now the whole route including the tunnels have been turned into a trail called the Monsall Trail for people to walk and cycle along. We're going to head over and take a little walk along some sections of it, and you can even walk through the old train tunnels. Although the Monsall Trail is a straight run effectively, it was a train track. There's a way we found where we can walk in a loop from the in a circle from the viaduct, so we can walk around the edge along the outside of one of the train tunnels along the riverbank here, which has stunning views but also a stunningly perilous drop into that river. So we can walk round the tunnel, back through the tunnel, back to the viaduct and back up to Monsall Head.
Think about it.
I was thinking, how did I end up here? Okay, now we've walked basically around one of the train tunnels, we can drop back down onto the track bed itself and walk back down the trail through one of these train tunnels. On the way here, we drove through the village of Bakewell. It was late and dark, but Chloe decided she wanted a Bakewell tart, so we said we'd come back in daylight. Despite the global nature of everything these days, food is still a very local thing. And I know people watch these around the world, so I'm aware you'll possibly have no idea what a Bakewell tart is. So I'm going to show you, or at least I'm going to show you what you can buy in most supermarkets throughout England, and I guess the rest of the UK. But this is way off topic, but anyway, Mr. Kipling is a brand conceived in the 1960s and I guess a byproduct of the supermarket. They make the kind of cakes you would have traditionally found in local bakers and adapt them to package them in a way supermarkets can stock and sell them. Mr. Kipling makes exceedingly good cakes. They are hugely popular and Britain's most loved cake brand. This is the French Fancy. Kids love them. Adults not so much, probably because we all OD'd on them as kids. But they are the gateway to the rest of the range. Apple pies, Battenbergs, treacle tarts, Viennese wells, and the cherry Bakewell. It turns out the Bakewell tart as we know it is a modern and convenient adaptation of the Bakewell pudding. So we're going to Bakewell to get some of the original Bakewell puddings. It gets a little weird when you get to Bakewell as there's more than one shop claiming to sell the original recipe and their recipe as the original. And Wikipedia says it was believed to have originated in a pub. So this is the small market town of Bakewell, famous for the Bakewell pudding. Two things seem popular here, fish and chips and Bakewell puddings. This is the Bakewell Pudding Factory, Pudding Parlour and Shop. This is the old original Bakewell Pudding Shop. And this is Bloomer's, the first and only original Bakewell Pudding Shop. We don't have time or the appetite to try all three and tell you which is best. We're going to go with Bloomers because I want to get a steak and Stilton pie as well. But if you've tried all three, let everyone know in the comments below which one you think is the best. To be honest, we looked at all three and they all looked identical, and the ingredients are so simple I can't imagine that the taste of each one is that different. Chloe's got herself a single portion Bakewell pudding. I've got two massive Bakewell puddings and a steak and Stilton pie. I had a slice of Bakewell pudding while editing this video. I can tell you they are delicious, and you can see precisely where Mr. Kipling got his inspiration for the Bakewell tart from. Quick snap, probably for Instagram. Don't forget to check out all of our social media links in the description below. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please hit the thumbs up like button. And if you'd like to be the first to see my new videos, the subscribe button. Toodles.
Not a
natural.
Well, that's natural.
Good,
no,
Chloe.
Yeah,
you don't touch it.
Don't touch the snot.
Can't snot, do I?